Good morning. Welcome to worship, whether you are joining us here in the sanctuary, whether you are visitors, and also whether you are joining us at home a little later as well. We gather together on this beautiful day, and I'm so excited because today is our not only a big dedication, but also a day when we will stay behind afterwards, hopefully, to join in hospitality. So that's a wonderful chance to gather together again. So I am going to ask Ava to come forward. Can you come forward? And light our Christ candle. Thank you so much. We are reminded that Christ is the light of the world and brings light to us to guide our path. And as we think about guiding our path and new visions, I'm going to invite Gavin to play a piece of music as we come into worship. Thank you, Gavin. Yep, you can if you want to. Gavin is joining us today because Marilyn has a day off. I believe her son is visiting from out west, I think, so she had arranged for this day off, which is why Gavin has joined us. Let us join together in our call to worship, which is written by Richard Bott, our moderator. Pay attention. Where? What? There, on the horizon before us, what do you notice? A new heaven and a new earth. Pay attention. Where? What? There, on the horizon behind us, what do you notice? The old heaven and and the old earth passing away. Pay attention.
Where?
What? Right here, with us, in us, around us. What do you experience?
The communion of the Holy Spirit, the peace of God, the love of Christ.
Alleluia.
Amen.
And we do indeed experience that new birth all the time in creation around us. So please join us in singing our first hymn from Voices United 703, In the Bulb There Is a Flower. Please stand as you are able. Unless, of course, you are young and young at heart, in which case, come on down the front here. Come on down.
Oh, come on forward. Let's
best way to know how to move forward. And that's what we're going to be talking about in church today. And I know that you've been talking a little bit about light as well in Sunday school. So you can be thinking a little bit more about that. So let's say a prayer, repeat after me, prayer, before you head down. I think you're making something exciting. Oh, shh, it's a secret. All right, put our hands together and close our eyes. And please join with us. Dear God, you are the light that helps us know the way forward. Help us to trust you and to trust your word. Amen. All right, you guys can hear that. You're going into the parlor today to do your work. How great to see so many little ones out again. And we are reminded that indeed God is the word that guides us forward and is the peace that surrounds us. So may the peace of Christ be always with you.
And also with you.
Please, I invite you to greet your family and your friends and your neighbors around you with the peace of Christ. Let us join together in our prayer of approach. God of all love, thank you for being the light that guides our path. Open our eyes to the joys and responsibilities of following your guiding light. And when we are confused, lost, or frustrated, help us to experience your voice, guiding us to places of life. In the name of the Shepherd we pray, amen. And let's join in singing the prayer that Jesus taught us.
Today we have two readings of scripture, both on the theme of visions. The first is from the Acts of the Apostles, Acts chapter 11, verses 1 to 18. The apostles and the brothers and sisters throughout Judea heard that even the Gentiles had welcomed God's word. When Peter went up to Jerusalem, the circumcised believers criticized him. They accused him You went into the home of the uncircumcised and ate with them. Step by step, Peter explained what had happened. I was in the city of Joppa praying when I had a visionary experience. In my vision, I saw something like a large linen sheet being lowered from heaven by its four corners. It came all the way down to me. As I stared at it, wondering what it was, I saw four-legged animals, including wild beasts, as well as reptiles and wild birds. I heard a voice say, "Get up, Peter, kill and eat." I responded, "Absolutely not, Lord. Nothing impure or unclean has ever entered my mouth." The voice from heaven spoke a second time. "Never consider unclean what God has made pure." This happened three times. Then everything was pulled back into heaven. At that moment, three men who had been sent to me from Caesarea arrived at the house where we were staying. The Spirit told me to go with them, even though they were Gentiles. These six brothers also went with me, and we entered that man's house. He reported to us how he had seen an angel standing in his house and saying, "Send to Joppa and summon Simon, who is known as Peter. He will tell you how you and your entire household can be saved." When I began to speak, the Holy Spirit fell on them, just as the Spirit fell on us in the beginning. I remembered the Lord's words, "John baptized with water, but you will be baptized with the Holy Spirit." If God gave them the same gift he gave us who believed in the Lord Jesus Christ, then who am I? Could I stand in God's way? Once the apostles and other believers heard this, they calmed down. They praised God and concluded, "So then God has enabled Gentiles to change their hearts and lives so that they might have new life." The second reading is taken from the book of Revelations, chapter 21, verses 1 to 6. "Then I saw a new heaven and a new earth, for the former heaven and the former earth had passed away, and the sea was no more. I saw the holy city, New Jerusalem, coming down out of heaven from God, made ready as a bride beautifully dressed for her husband. I heard a loud voice from the throne say, 'Look, God's dwelling is here with humankind. He will dwell with them, and they will be his peoples. God himself will be with them as their God. He will wipe away every tear from their eyes. Death will be no more. There will be no mourning, crying, or pain anymore, for the former things have passed away.' Then the one seated on the throne said, 'Look, I'm making all things new.' He also said, 'Write this down, for these words are trustworthy and true.' Then he said to me, 'All is done. I am the Alpha and the Omega, the beginning and the end. To the thirsty, I will freely give water from the life-giving spring.'" Listen to what the Spirit is saying to the church.
Our next hymn might be a new one to you, so I encourage you, if you wish, to pick up the hymn books. It's from More Voices, 155, "Unbounded Spirit, Breath of God." Please stand as you are able.
Thank you. Christ and to no other name. Receive and open for review the work we do and words we preach, and school us as we teach and
see you. Come and open our ears so we might hear you. Come and open our hearts so we understand what you are saying to us today. Amen. Well, how many of you here have ever had a really vivid dream? One when you can almost hear yourself speaking in the dream, where maybe you recognize the people in the dream, you recognize where you are even, and you see it in so much detail that you honestly think it's real. So put your hand up if you've ever had a dream like that. Yes, pretty much everybody. And don't worry if you didn't put your hand up, because I can tell you that even if you didn't remember it, you did dream. Everybody dreams. In fact, research has shown that the average person dreams between 3 to 5 dreams per night. And scientifically, the most vivid dreams occur during a period that's called the rapid eye movement stage of sleep, the REM stage. Now, I'm not a scientist, so this has fascinated me. And apparently during that stage, that's when your brain activity is most awake and most resembles the time that you are awake. So I can tell you that even if you didn't remember your dream, it's probably because you didn't dream during that period, because we all dream. A study of dreams is actually fascinating. There's been so much written about it, about the purpose of dreams and the content of dreams. I'm sure you're all familiar with Sigmund Freud. Everybody heard that name? Pretty much everyone, I'd imagine. He wrote extensively about dreams and how they reveal hidden desires and emotions. And other prominent theories include those suggesting that dreams help us with memory formation. There's actually clinics that do that, help you dream to help you get your memory back. And there's dreams help us with problem solving. And in many indigenous cultures, Dreams serve as a validation for your spiritual condition and your spiritual awakening. According to the Anishinaabe people, children learn from an early age to remember their dreams. And then these dreams are interpreted by tribal elders who reveal the symbols of their dreams and guide them into deeper wisdom and sometimes spiritual healing. Dreams are important. Although an understanding of dreams is not definitive, and you might be sitting there thinking, it's all nonsense, you cannot deny that dreams have been the topic of scientific speculation, the subject of philosophical and religious interests throughout history, including our biblical history. Our faith heritage story is full of dreams and visions. To name just a few, hopefully you might know some of these, there's Jacob's dream of the ladder and the wrestling with God. Put your hand up if you've heard some of these. Nebuchadnezzar's two dreams in the book of Daniel. And I bet you all know this one, Joseph's many dreams. Oh, come on, you've all heard of Andrew Lloyd Webber. Yes, thanks to Andrew Lloyd Webber, I'm pretty sure that many of you have heard of Joseph and the Technicolor dream coat. And in the Gospel of Matthew, there are five recorded dreams around the Holy Family and the birth of Jesus. Pilate's wife also has a dream that she tells her husband about in terms of sparing Jesus' life. The book of Revelations opens with a series of visions. And then, of course, there's Peter's dream that we heard about today in Acts. There's more, that's just to name a few. Prophetic dreams and visions are the backbone of our faith tradition. But how are they relevant to us today? Theologian and Hebrew scholar Walter Brueggemann, in his book Prophetic Imagination, says, we can learn a lot from the ancient dreams and visions of our faith story. He writes, the task is reframing them so we can re-experience the social realities that are right in front of us from a different angle. Looking at what those dreams mean to us today, those visions mean for us today. In an interview, Brueggemann said that he would always tell his students as they were studying the prophets that this stuff sounds like it was written yesterday because the contemporary nature of it is so immediate. I think that's true. When you go back and you look at those visions and those dreams, they're actually very contemporary. Peter's vision that we had just now heard is contemporary. Peter had a very vivid and detailed dream. I guess he must have dreamt during that REM period or something, because he certainly remembered it when he woke up. He reports his vision step by step to the Jewish disciples. And he tells them that he heard God speaking to him in his vision, saying it's okay to eat non-kosher food. He says the voice from heaven spoke, saying, never consider unclean what God has made pure. And in his vision, he sees these non-kosher animals in real detail. And then he goes on to say that in his vision, he's told to go into the house of the uncircumcised Gentiles. The Spirit told me to go with them even though they were Gentiles. This was groundbreaking stuff back then. I mean, the Jews and the Gentiles were very separate and different cultures. They didn't mix. Hence the words, even though they were Gentiles. It would be forbidden for him to go into a Gentile's house. At this point, the disciples did not believe that the Gentiles should be part of the early church. They thought that they were just a small, elite group, and that Jesus' message was just for them. When I hear these words, I sometimes think you have to wonder, where were they when Jesus said, love your neighbor as yourself? But Peter's vision, he helps them to understand that the Gentiles are their neighbors. His vision shows them the future of the early church. And of course, the church went on to grow in leaps and bounds. What vision do we have of our future today? Well, in 2015, Disney released a movie called Tomorrowland. In it, they depicted the future city of 2050. So take a little look at this for a second. Well, there you have it, 2050. Of course, I have absolutely no idea if we will be flying around on jetpacks or traveling on hover rails in the sky. Although I do think it's pretty likely that by 2050, John, when we move on to the next one? Next slide. Otherwise we'll play it again. That's it, that's fine. I do think, though, that by 2050, that probably all of us will be driving electric cars, believe it or not. And sadly, it's also predicted that if we do not do anything about climate crisis, then the environmental disasters will also become commonplace. Many animals and aquatic life will become extinct. Parts of the world will simply become uninhabitable by 2050. We can already see that happening. Recently, in the news in Pakistan, record temperatures of 47 degrees. The heat closed the schools, it damaged crops, it put pressure on energy. Residents were warned to remain indoors and keep hydrated. The prophetic words and warnings of environmentalists like Greta Thunberg need to be heeded, just like Peter's vision for the early church. And what vision do we have for our church as well? This is perhaps a particularly poignant question for you at Grace United as you start the process of looking for a new minister. This process begins with asking yourselves the question, what vision do you have for this community of faith? Some of you may have different visions, but it's important for you to work together to create a common vision. It's important that all voices are heard on the search team. Who are you? What is your identity? What is your vision? As you work together, you may find that there are some things that you do have to let go of. I'm sure that 5 years ago, you never would imagine that you would have PowerPoint instead of bulletins, or that you would have clips from a Disney movie as part of your message. It's okay to let go of some things. The vision in Revelation's reading today reminds us that there should be no mourning, crying, or pain for the former things that have passed away. But at the same time, as you consider your vision for this church, it's also important to know that there are things that you will need to own, to carry with you, things that are part of your roots and part of your identity. You've probably heard it said that the United Church is like a great big tent with many different theological views, from the conservative to the more progressive. And neither of those views are wrong or even opposing, as long as you have God as the center post in the middle of your tent, holding you up. I know that the days ahead may seem a little bit uncertain for you at Grace, that your vision may not be clear right now, but I truly believe that God is preparing someone to come and be your minister. And I encourage you to hold on to the promise that God is the Alpha and the Omega, the beginning and the end. As you create a search team and as you begin your process of moving forward, be sure to keep God as that post in the center of your vision. Always be thirsty for God. And as you step to a new phase for Grace, remember, to the thirsty, God will give freely water from the life-giving spring. May you be blessed with that water. Amen. As we come into a time of prayer, our call to prayer reminds us to keep our hearts and our minds open to listening to the Spirit of God. We will sing it twice through the beginning and then interspersed throughout the prayer as well. Holy Creator, we pray for the world. We know that it is not the creation that you envisioned. We pray that world leaders will heed the warnings of climate change and be willing to make policies rooted in hope for the future. We pray for the conflict in Ukraine and for the thousands of people that have been left homeless. Help us to respond by opening our doors to refugees, providing aid where needed, and working towards a vision of peace. And we pray for those closer to home, where the ever-rising prices make it difficult for some to put food on the table and a roof over their heads. Guide government leaders in the upcoming election to make issues of poverty, sustainable living, and affordable housing a priority. Guide us in your vision, Holy One. Jesus, light of the world, In your ministry, you taught us how to live in a way of compassion and love for all people. We pray now for those that we know that need to feel your loving comfort. In the silence of our hearts, we name those that are grieving. Those that are sick or awaiting tests and surgery. Those that are lonely, anxious, or just need your guiding light. And we pray especially for the victims and families of yesterday's mass shooting in the US, a racist hate crime. Surround all those that we have named and all those that have no one to pray for them. Help us as people of faith to always seek to reach out in love. Guide us in your vision, Holy One. Spirit of hope, we pray for this community of faith. As the people of grace begin the journey to seek a new minister, help them to work together to create a vision of who they are. Open their ears to listen to each other and guide them with your spirit to be the people that you want them to be. Give us the courage to be willing to sometimes let go of the old and to make way for the new. And remind us daily to keep God in the center of all we do. The Alpha and the Omega. Guide us in your vision, Holy One. Pray in the name of the Holy One, Holy Three, Holy Divine. Amen. So as we come now to a time, just finding my notes, sorry, a time of life from Mission of Grace, thank you. So that's all right. So there's a few things to bring to your attention. First of all, the Kylie Jo Masson tickets. If you haven't got yours yet, I encourage you to get one. It will be a fun event, a chance to come together as a community. And it's a great opportunity as well to outreach. So if you bought one for yourself, buy another one and give it to somebody who doesn't normally come to church so they can come and have a really good time at church. Also, the yard sale, there will be more information in the newsletter this coming week as to when to drop your things off for the yard sale, all the different times and so forth will be available in the newsletter. And I'd like now to invite Anne to come forward, who's going to tell us some information about our call for volunteers.
Good morning, folks. I'm here to ask you about volunteering to be on the committee to continue the work of the Grace United Church food booth at the Tavistock Fall Fair. That's a booth that's been going on for I have no idea how long. Marie Ruppel used to tell me about doing full-blown meals. They cooked, you know, meat, potatoes, vegetables, served them. Fortunately, we've stopped doing that, and things change. But I do know that having been involved working there and helping organize a few years ago, that the folk that go to the fair always enjoy coming to the Tavistock food booth because they know they'll get good food, and they get to visit with their friends and neighbors, too, while they're there. So, this plea is for, well, to honor, first of all, the folk that were on that committee for the last 20 years. That's a long time for the same people to look after something, and no doubt about it, it's a lot of work. They've put in good many hours planning and getting things going. They have all kinds of records, so you don't need to reinvent the wheel. They're sharing what they already know and the lists that they've made and one thing another. If you or someone that you know would think that this is something we should carry on as a church, that would be wonderful. The Ag Society needs to know by June, or first part of June, if we will be having the food booth there. I'm sure that they enjoy having that booth and would want to continue having something in that same spot. So, if you or someone you know is willing to help out and continue on, that's fine. If no one comes forward, I guess 3 years ago was the last time that Grace United Church would have a food booth at the Tavistock Fall Fair. Something to think about. Thank you.
Thank you, Anne. And I would just add to that message that it's a great way to be a presence in the community as well. So reaching out. So I'd like to invite Bill up now, because another way that we give as a wonderful dedication that we have today is of our new signs. I'm going to have Bill to come up and say a few words first of all.
John, can you go to the next slide?
Thank you, Gail. We certainly appreciate the opportunity to be with everybody here today as we dedicate the new sign up front. Our family has a long history in this church. It goes back, our family has a long history in this church that goes back to the early 1920s when my grandfather was a minister here, Reverend George Brown. He was a minister here back in, I think it was about 1920 to 1925. And then my grandparents, some of you will remember them, Wilford and Lydia Brown, went to this church all their married life as well. When Grandpa passed away, my grandmother, Lydia, and the rest of the family wanted to donate something to the church in his memory. The old sign that was just removed is what they gave approximately 50 years ago. I think it was in the early 70s. So that sign lasted for 50 years, which is pretty good. Hopefully the new sign will last just as long. So when Mom and Dad, which is Claire and Jean, and Mom's here today, Jean recently sold the farm, they heard that the church was thinking of replacing the old sign. They thought that it would make sense to donate a new sign, as the old one was in memory of Grandpa, who purchased the original home farm where I live in the Tavistock area. I would like to thank the committee that looked after designing the sign and working with Sign Ontario from Stratford to get the sign erected and up and running. The committee was headed by Dale Brenneman. He was kind of the front man. Dale's up in the balcony here today, and he certainly did a lot to get things organized and get things rolling. The others on the committee included Eugene and Marcia Bender, we're here as well, Beth Kaufman, Wanda and I. Also like to thank John Markle and Keith Weitzel, who assisted with getting the sign connected to the church computer, which wasn't a real easy thing either, and getting all that work done. And also thank you to Reverend Gail and Catherine for Brenneman for figuring out how to get the messages there. Not a real easy thing either when you're working with technology, but it is amazing how it works. So. The other thing that I wanted to mention, and when you get out there, you'll be able to see it, but a lot of thought was put into the design. Beth and Marcia and Wanda, the ladies, tend to be good at the design work, and Eugene and Dale worked on the engineering and the building permits and all that sort of thing. So it was a good committee because everybody had expertise in certain areas, so it worked out very well. So as I was saying, there was a lot of thought went into the design. If you'll notice, there's a cross on the new sign. If you look at that cross and look at the cross in the entrance to the church, it's the same design. You'll also notice that the printing for Grace United Church is in the same type of, I don't know whether it's Gothic or what it is, but same design as well. So, and then the posts that are on the corner come to kind of a peak. And if you look at the corner of the church, there's a post with a peak on it that looks the same way. And also the curve on the sign was kind of designed to look like the curve on the front entrance to the church. So I think it wasn't just, well, we'll pick that sign. It was kind of some thought went into it, and they worked with Sign Ontario in order to make that happen. And then the other thing that the family certainly appreciated is to tie the old sign into the new one. The committee also added the scripture, "My peace I give to you," which is John 14:27. It was on the old sign, and we carried that forward to the new one. So that was kind of the link, and we were very pleased about that. So the family is very pleased with the new signs. We've had lots of really good comments about it. We certainly appreciate that. And I just want to say a big thank you to everyone that was involved. So, thank you.
So it's kind of hard to bring the sign in here to physically dedicate it. So at the end of the service, we will go out and we will have a ribbon cutting ceremony and have another prayer out there. But I would like to have a prayer of dedication right now, if we can move to the next slide, and for you to join in afterwards. So let us pray. Jesus said, "Go into the world and proclaim the gospel." Today we celebrate our wonderful new sign that speaks messages of hope into the community of Tavistock. May it proclaim the work that God is doing among the people here at Grace. May it encourage others to know that a warm welcome awaits in this community of faith. We give thanks to the generosity of the Brown family for their donation of this gift, and we dedicate it to the glory of God today and for many years to come, as we say together, with gratitude, we accept this gift. We will care for it, and we will use it wisely. Amen. And as we think about our gifts, I'm going to invite Blair to come up and sing for us as we take up our offering. The song that they will be singing is "Full of Hope for Tomorrow." I invite the ushers to come forward and collect the plates.
The sun will come out tomorrow, bet your bottom dollar that tomorrow there'll be sun. Just thinking about tomorrow clears away the cobwebs and the sorrow till there's none. When I'm stuck with a day that's gray and lonely, I just stick out my chin and grin and say, oh, the sun will come out tomorrow, so you got to hang on till tomorrow, come what may. Tomorrow, you're always a day off.
Thank you. What a hopeful message. Please stand as you are able.
Know that wherever you go,
God walks the road before you. Jesus walks beside you. And the Holy Spirit surrounds you, encircles you, and fills you with peace. Amen. I invite you now, as Gavin plays, to lean out to the church and gather around the sign at the front. And after that, we will gather into the fellowship hall for a beautiful cake that has been made by us. I'm looking forward to seeing it. Thank you very much. And we will see you out there.